Welcome to this Fertility Within Reach webinar, Men's Health Month. Let's talk about sex during infertility. I am Jennifer Neely, a Fertility Within Reach board member who will be moderating this webinar. If you use social media, please just tag Fertility Within Reach. This webinar is part of a series that aims to educate and raise funds for our advocacy efforts. If you're in a position to donate, we would appreciate a donation of any amount. Your funds go directly to those affected and in need. You can donate directly on our website, Fertility Within Reach, or on Facebook. Let's turn to our fantastic panel. I'm going to ask each of you to introduce yourself, and let's start with sex therapist, fertility specialist, speaker, and author, Elliott Kronenfeld. Welcome, Elliott.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I am a sex therapist. I'm a certified sex therapist and sex therapist supervisor. I have an office in Brooklyn and in Newton, Massachusetts. I am in the waning days of my Ph.D. in human sexuality, which I'm very excited about. So that's coming to an end. But I have spent the last 20 plus years working with singles and couples around the world to work through issues around fertility and family formation. Everything from IVF and surrogacy and adoption and foster care, and really looking at the options for how we create our families when it is a challenge for us. But I think that the other part that I really spend a lot of time working on beyond the biophysical part of this journey is really looking at the connection and the relationships that we have that allow us to build really strong families, because it starts with the connections that you have going through this journey, not only with your partner if you have one, but with your community and the people who support you, because nobody goes through this journey alone. And I think it's really important, and I'm very excited to have this conversation tonight with good and dear friends who I've spoken with before, because I know they're gonna say really smart and insightful things. And I'm very excited to hear what they have to say as well. So thank you.
Wonderful, Elliott. Thank you so much. It's so exciting to have you here. To be able to get into this. It's lovely when we have panelists that know each other. So next we have a familiar face you may recognize from her many media appearances, relationship expert and author, Andrea Syrtash. Welcome, Andrea.
Hello, I'm very happy to be here. Yes, I've been really lucky to join Elliott on panels before and Davina, and I'm thrilled to, you know, be here. We're speaking about sex and infertility, so I'm in bed during this conversation, but also because it's a quiet place to speak. But just in terms of my background, in a quick nutshell, I'm an author, as you mentioned, a media on-air personality, sharing relationship advice for many, many years in many outlets. I've hosted TV shows for networks like the Oprah Network and Discovery. And I wrote a book called Cheat on Your Husband with Your Husband. And then in year 5 or 6 of my own infertility journey, I launched a site called Pregnant-ish, which was the first non-medical site. I have to clarify that. Not the first site about infertility, but the first editorial lifestyle kind of media site helping people navigate infertility and fertility treatments. And the reason I launched it is because as a relationship personality, constantly sharing about sex, love, marriage, everything in between, I felt like we were missing a massive chapter of modern day relationships, which was this, infertility. So Pregnant-ish is a great platform, which we tell the stories of families built through science and technology, and we support people, I hope, who are struggling along the way.
Rounding out our wonderful panel is Fertility Within Reach's fearless leader, Davina Fankhauser. Davina is co-founder of Fertility Within Reach. We're a 501c3 national nonprofit organization. Davina brings her perspective working directly with patients to put the power of advocacy, education, and community organizing into their hands to help them control their healthcare destinies. Davina, welcome to the conversation and over to you.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. We are so lucky you are on our board and producing this evening. And I want to thank Elliott and Andrea. I've witnessed your brilliance before, and I'm so happy and excited that you are joining us today. I love this topic. I love this topic because I don't think it's out there enough. And especially during Men's Health Men's Health Awareness Month and Pride Month, I thought it was really important for us to let's talk about sex during infertility or while you're trying to create your family, because there's just so much stress and pressure when you're trying to build that family that sometimes I think people can feel alone, even within their own relationship. And so I'm hoping that people who are attending or listening, they'll learn something, they'll realize they're not alone, they'll hear a tip or a suggestion that maybe might change things to make life a little bit easier for them as they go through this journey. So I would really love to hear kind of your thoughts on what you think might be missing in this discussion and what you would like to tap into.
What's missing in this discussion is exactly what we're bringing hopefully to the forefront today, which is that first comes love, then comes marriage, then comes a baby carriage is a really outdated narrative that doesn't serve a lot of people anymore. We're skipping steps, we're missing steps, we're mixing up the order of steps. And family building today is not a linear process for so many people. And what do we do with intimacy during infertility, which I just want to say off the bat, and we'll get into a deeper discussion about this, but I believe it can increase intimacy in so many ways, but obviously we have challenges around it too. So that's what I think is missing for sure.
I would add to that too. I think you're both hitting on something that's really important, but I think it starts long before we try to build our families. You know, I think it really starts with the scripts and the narratives that we're given as we're growing up and what we're told is expected of us and how we're supposed to show up in relationships and what a meaningful adult life looks like. Because when we put the fertility piece into a silo, that's what makes it really hard to cope with as well, because it doesn't operate in a silo. It really does impact every other part of our lives. And the problem is we don't start to address it until we start having problems. We don't think about it and, you know, how does it impact the rest of me? And so, you know, Andrea, I love that you're talking about, you know, the old narratives don't work anymore, but many times we're still given those old scripts that need to be edited, and they need to be edited earlier, which means we also need to do better in education and the way that we raise our young people so that the next generation of folks coming up actually have more control over who they are as sexual beings and what they want from relationships.
I think that's absolutely, you know, spot on. I do think the conversation has changed. I'm a little bit in the older generation. I don't even know what my generation, if we had a name. And
you're not that old, Davina.
Thank you. I'll take it. But, you know, I don't think we had a name, but certainly the discussion about our relationship, our needs, our questions, that wasn't really encouraged to be discussed within a relationship. And I think that's changed over time. So what do we tell, you know, the millennials of now about how to talk about sex with your partner?
Davina, I think you're right, right? Is that the fact that now we're supposed to have these conversations, but we're not taught how to have these conversations, but yet we get these messages from social media, from movies, from the world about what it's supposed to look like, but we don't know how to talk about it. I spend an extraordinary amount of time here in my practice teaching people how to talk about it, teaching them how to use intention and curiosity as real strategic relationship skills. How do you show up, and how do you use curiosity to invest into not only your relationship, but into what it is you're trying to build that gratifies you? But we don't talk about relationships in those ways. We don't talk about relationships from the place of, you know, it is an ongoing investment that I have to be curious about because it is constantly fluid. It is constantly changing. We are often told, in fact, just the opposite, that once you make a decision to be in a relationship, that's the decision and now you're in it. And so you just kind of stop, you get stuck there. And what we have to train people and educate people and open up to people is that, no, that's the first decision. But there are still decisions along the way that you have to ask for yourself and then ask of your partner.
I definitely agree with you, Elliott. And it starts with the relationship with yourself. So I think what we don't always do a good job of is empowering younger, way younger than millennial. I mean, like teenagers and people when we're starting our reproductive lives, you know, when we start menstruating, it's amazing if you polled America about how babies are made. People don't know the difference between an egg and an embryo and what ovulation is and when the window they can get pregnant and all these things that some of us take for granted when we're really trying and we've studied this. You know, we don't even know what's happening within our own bodies. And it's not just our physical bodies, obviously. We want to have a good, solid, healthy relationship with ourselves, know what we value, know what's important to us, live by that, respect ourselves, respect our bodies. Like all of that has to happen way, way before we think, I think.
I think that is so spot on. One of the questions I ask a lot of couples that really stymies them is, what is your definition of healthy sexuality? Like, just what is healthy sexuality? And what are the qualities of that? And then as we start going through that, and to your point, Andrea, when I start talking about, so let's talk about the body parts. How many people don't even know the names of their body parts? They don't.
Or they can't say them aloud without.
Or they can't say them
giggling.
Aloud. Right? Or they have these childish, funny nicknames because it's the only way they can cope with it. And I, you know, I'll ask them, like, what kind of language do you use? I mean, we can talk very clinically. We can talk like we're on a porn set. I'm like, but what is your language? What do you use? And most times I get, well, nothing. We don't. You know, we really need to get to people earlier. This is, you know, Men's Health Month. So I want to make a comment about men. I am right now in the midst of doing some really deep research with men. And I've been interviewing men all over North America around some issues regarding sexuality and their sex lives and asking them, so what did you think your role was? And it's fascinating because almost unanimously, these men have said, well, to be a good provider. I've been told as long as I'm a good provider, everything else will take care of itself. But it didn't. Mm-hmm. And I can't believe it. I don't know how I got here. Mm-hmm. And that to me is fascinating. So what messages are we giving our young men about what their job is, first of all, as a human being and as an adult, and as a relationship partner? What does it mean to have healthy sexuality? And what does it mean to be a good sexual partner, even before we get to the concept of conception?
Well, I almost feel like that the answers would be different coming from a man versus a woman. Yes, there are books about men and women having different languages or love languages, or men are from Mars, women are from Venus. But is there any common ground where they speak the same language, or is it always a little bit different where men and women might, they just have a different perspective because of how they were raised? Or is there any common understanding that they can build off of?
You know, it's interesting because oftentimes when I say I'm a relationships author, people will say, what's your biggest tip? Like, what's the number one relation? And I used to say there isn't one. There's 1,000 tips, you know. But I realized there actually is a common thread. And it doesn't matter how old you are, what gender you are, what sexual orientation, it doesn't matter. And I did a TEDx talk on this. What I believe is what's universally needed is acknowledgement. Yep. Acknowledgement fuels relationships and makes relationships. Do you see me? Do you hear me? Do you value me? Now, it might manifest a little differently. I'm sure, Elliott, you see this in your practice with men and women. I think women, if I had to really generalize, women thrive on attention, men thrive on approval. If I had to like make it a little, you know, define it a little more, but all of it is about acknowledgement, and acknowledgement is powerful with kids and their parents, right, in a workplace, in any context we look at, not just intimate romantic relationships.
I think that when we talk about gender, this is a really important distinction that I think needs to be made. You know, sex is that biological sex. People with penises or people with uteruses, you know, really looking at what is the biological function of sex. Mm-hmm. Gender really is a social construct. Building off what Andrea just said, because I agree with her 1,000%, because if you're a woman in the Middle East versus a woman in France versus a woman in an indigenous culture, mm-hmm. the way you are socialized and what your role is and how you're going to show up is going to be very different. And the same is true with a man. You put a man in any of those cultures and they're going to show up differently. So I think there is this real cultural element. So to this point of acknowledgement, I think is exactly right, because that's how we're talking about the social construct of gender. So when we say Men's Health Month, I'm not actually really sure what that means, because who's the man? And, you know, how is that gender showing up? I do think that when people ask me the same questions about what are my biggest tips and what are the biggest advices I have, is first of all, edit your script. Whatever script you've got, you have to decide whether that's the script you want. And where it works for you, great, hold it, go with it. But if that script isn't working for you, you have to ask yourself why and what you're going to do about it. And also, too, to help them understand some core concepts, such as, as I said earlier, what is healthy sexuality? But one of the other big pieces is, what is intimacy? Anyone who's ever worked with me, anyone who's read my book, anyone who's seen my TED Talk knows that I'm very, very, very clear that intimacy is this balance between safety and vulnerability. And we really have to balance those two things out, right? Because if we're so safe that we can't allow vulnerability and we're closed off, and if we're so vulnerable that we can't feel safe, we're terrified. Right. And so especially when we start talking about things that are so intimate or scary or confusing, like sex and reproduction, right. It really does require a high degree of intimacy. So we have to figure out how to balance that safety and vulnerability so that you can move forward into that journey and feel like you've got a grasp on it.
Of course, Elliott and I are so like-minded, and I always agree with you, because one of my isms that I often say is, you can't have intimacy without vulnerability. You That's cannot. Right. They cannot. It's not possible without That's that. Right. Sex can be so vulnerable, and when it's not working and you don't feel as hot and sexy and spicy, and it used to come naturally because literally your brains were different when you were falling in love. Like yes. literally different, yeah. physiologically different, when it was really easy to just get it on. I mean, let's be honest, like you didn't have to work too hard to make yeah. that happen in uh-huh. the early days. So when you have to kind of, when you transition into what Dr. Helen Fisher refers to as the attachment phase, well, that's when a lot of the real work happens of relationships, which can have much deeper intimacy, but it's not as easy.
When I said earlier that I wanted your brilliance to come out, I was not exaggerating, because I'm listening to the two of you. And Elliott, what you were saying about the cultural connection, it just blew my mind. Like a light bulb went off. I had never thought of it that way, that it could be the same sex, but in different cultures around the world, there can be a different meaning. It's just brilliant. And I'm so grateful you're sharing it with everybody. I do think there is like confusion or a misunderstanding about what intimacy is. And so you sharing that intimacy is, it's okay to be vulnerable.
You need it for intimacy.
And required.
It's right. required.
And I think when people go through infertility, they often try to be strong for the other person, not vulnerable. I think it almost naturally can build up a wall. I would love to hear, Andrea, your thoughts about how it could even enhance the connection between a couple mm-hmm. Going through infertility, because I think probably a lot of people listening or watching are really wondering, how in the world can that yeah. be?
I know. And I've done, and I didn't mention in my intro that I went through 8 years of treatments, 18 fertility treatments, a lot of losses before my angel cousin delivered my embryo. Yeah. It's now my little girl. I know deeply, and I was on book tour while I was going through infertility with my husband. But here's the good news. Studies show that relationships don't break up because of infertility. So if you were going to break up, essentially, if you break up over infertility, something else, another stressor in life, which happens, probably would have split you up. And in fact, I've interviewed countless couples now who say my relationship is stronger because of infertility, because I was never more vulnerable when my partner was giving me shots. I was never more vulnerable, or we were never more connected when we had to make these hard decisions and support each other and communicate. So it depends how you handle that. It's like the ultimate test that none of us wanted. But it can really build a great intimacy, because again, when sex isn't, I'm so jealous always of people who, you know, make babies the fun way, because it's like either the most pleasurable or the most painful experience, depending on where you land. But there's a lot of beauty that comes with this pain of learning about yourselves, your partnership, your communication, which relationships, not just with your intimate partner, but which relationships are worth keeping, which are, you know, time to say goodbye. You're not my person anymore. You know, a friend who's not supportive, you quickly see this person doesn't serve me anymore. So it can be a blessing. It can really be a blessing in relationships. And that's a really hard perspective to consider when you're struggling.
Yeah, I'm going to make a couple of comments on that. What's really interesting is that I think, you know, being a man in this field serves me really well, because I actually get couples to come in. And I think it's really often hard to get a man into therapy and getting a man to go, sometimes go to the doctor's appointments, but then it's like, okay, you know, I'm the non-gestating partner, so I don't have to do that stuff. That's your work to do. And so one of the things that I love being a man is the guy will come in and will sit and talk to me. And I love working with couples as they're going through infertility or fertility, depending on what their situation is. And I'm very clear about talking about, you know, before we jump into the whole like medical process, because you're going to get so medicalized, And that alone is painful. That your body becomes not yours, and you lose control over your body, either because all of a sudden you're so hepped up on hormones or you're on somebody else's schedule. It's really a challenging experience. And getting a couple to learn how to communicate in a new way that they've never had to communicate before is such good work. I get so excited about it, because I teach them that, you know, talking to your intimate partner on a good day is hard, because you're going to talk to them in a unique language that is different than any other communication you're going to have. You lay fertility on top of that, and you're adding the medicalization on top of that. They often will then start to get stuck on, well, who's the patient? Who's the patient? Who has the problem? And really breaking that down, I'm like, no. It's not about whose body is functioning one way or not functioning another. It's the two of you have this challenge. And you both have to be invested, regardless of whether, you know, somebody has, you know, a challenging uterine lining, or a man has a motility problem, or whatever the problem is. I mean, if that's what you're focusing on, you're missing the relational aspect of this. And what I want you to do is I want you to put that fertility challenge over there. See that thing over there? It's you and me with that thing. That we are partners. That's our goal. And it's about teaching them how to frame it differently and telling them things like, you know what, there's no such thing as good or bad data, right? When you get news, it's not good news or bad news. Data is just data. And it just tells you whether you're going to go left or whether you're going to go right. And you have to be able to, you know, take your moment, have your reaction. We're all emotional, right? We feel this. But it is just a data point. Mm-hmm. And we have to be able to be on the same page and say, how are we going to work with this data point, that thing over there? But what often happens is that thing comes between us. And so this thing about relationship that Andrea is talking about is we have to look how to triangulate ourselves differently. So it's not sitting between us, but it's sitting beside us, because we're on the same side.
I love that. You both just share. It sounds like common sense, but I can honestly tell you, I think most people don't put two and two together and make those connections. And those are vital connections. I think one thing believe it or not, I get calls all the time, and people are concerned about their treatment. They share some of the most personal things with me because they're not sure who else to talk to. And you know, when we're all about advocacy, but we include advocating for yourself with your doctor or with a counselor, because what I find is people can get very quiet, especially when it comes to sex. I'll tell you the two things that I have heard. One is when it's timed and the wife contacts someone and says it's time, and then there's a husband or a partner involved and they try to have intercourse and then it's just not working. There's just so much pressure. And then the other thing I hear is maybe a woman who's had experience with pregnancy loss. And so then she's afraid of, and he or they are afraid of any kind of intimacy or vaginal penetration or anything because they're afraid it might lead to another miscarriage. Those are the two issues that I hear the most.
I want to make a comment to both those, and I know Andrea has something to say as well. The thing about timed sex, there's this really sad social commentary that we believe that men can get it up and perform on cue. They just want to have sex all the time and that this is easy for them. And in fact, it should be better for them because then they get more of it, right? There's all of these false narratives. And in fact, it is extraordinarily hard for men to perform on cue. And then the shaming that goes along with that and the attack on their perceived sense of masculinity and manhood. It is a very emasculating process, actually. And if they're seen as like, that's your only role, and especially being the non-gestating partner,
right,
the one thing I'm supposed to do, and I can't do it. It can be really painful for him. The second piece that you brought up is also really critical, especially if there's loss or pain involved. Because we don't raise men in a great way to deal with emotional processing. You know, I hate to be really gender stereotyped, but you know, if I had to put gender buckets out there, it's that men, this misnomer that we have that men are supposed to be horny but never needy, and women are supposed to be needy but never angry. Like these really awful stereotypes. In reality, nothing pulls that out more than a fertility journey. And we have to unpack that stuff and say neither one of those is true. I'll give a quick resource. Teresa Crenshaw, a number of years ago, wrote a very small but very powerful book called The Alchemy of Love and Sex. And what she talks about is the chemicals in our brain and in our body that lead to sexual functioning and lead to the way that our sexual functioning drives our behaviors. Like a really little book, it's available on audiobook as well, but it lines it up nicely about why biological sex men and women are different at different stages of their lifetime. And we are just never compatible from a chemical perspective until we're in our mid 50s. And by then, well, hello, menopause and varipause. Most people don't know that men also have a menopause called varipause, where we go through the same kind of hormonal rebalancing, but because it doesn't impact us in the same way menopause impacts women, we don't pay attention to it because we don't pay attention to men's health, really, right? Which is why men die quicker and sicker. But the only time we actually become chemically compatible is at menopause and varipause, and by then, fertility window is closed.
I really appreciate, Elliott, that you're bringing in the male perspective, because when we speak about fertility, first of all, over 30% of infertility is male factor. We know that. And yet it's still so often pegged as a woman's issue. And even when it's the woman's issue, we don't talk about the men. We just don't talk about the men enough. So
or the comorbid.
Or how they're a team, how we're a team. So if we're in a heterosexual, of course, partnership. So I so appreciate you brought that in. I was going to say one of the biggest pieces of simple advice, and I often say I challenge conventional wisdom a lot with common sense. all my book titles are that, if you look up my book titles. I want couples trying to conceive to really get it on when they're not ovulating, when there's no chance for a baby to happen. It's really important. Because then we remember that we're lovers and partners. We're not just baby-making machines. I think it's essential. And if you don't want to, you know, you just don't have the drive to have that much sex, it can still be dating each other, courting each other, flirting with each other, connecting with each other outside of the fertile window.
So that sounds a little penetrative.
Right. It doesn't have to be penetrative. So like, that sounds a bit counterintuitive for sex during infertility advice, but it leads to better sex during infertility.
I so echo that so much.
It's something that men and women need to hear. I think it's such a disservice that there aren't more conversations and resources. And I know we're trying to catch up with the times and talk about this more for men, but I think the focus of infertility resting on women hasn't necessarily, it is a disservice to women, but it is such a disrespect and a disservice to men. And so, you know, I'm always excited for the opportunity to bring attention and to try to figure out a way to include them in the conversation and try to find resources or ideas to help them as well. And I think when each person feels acknowledged, then they have a better chance of working together as a team.
They have to see themselves. I mean, we have a mission at Pregnantish. Diversity and storytelling is part of our core mission. So it's not just rich, white, older career women going through infertility that we cover. We have a series of amazing male writers. This weekend for Father's Day, we're publishing a number of their perspectives. But that is sad that that's noticed, like that's just not what we see. And we have to change that narrative too.
Right. But we see that all the way through the entire pregnancy journey.
Yes, absolutely.
Because when you're the non-gestating partner, what's your role? Right. And if you don't understand your role and you don't understand the impact that you have, you shrink away. And you disappear, or you feel belittled. And I mean, it goes all the way through the delivery. You're in the hospital, and the first question everyone asks is, how's mother and child?
You know, Elliott, it's weird because I had a gestational carrier, so I didn't gestate. It was my embryo, but I didn't deliver her. And I wondered during that if I was telling people when they said, what does it feel like? I said, maybe I feel like the husband in this case.
it's interesting, isn't it?
So that's a dynamic also with female infertility. Those of us who need gestational or traditional surrogacy, all of it is so layered.
I'm actually really interested in this, Andrea, because one of the things that, I mean, we see it in it's like the classic movie scene, right? Where the woman is in the wheelchair being wheeled out of the hospital with the baby. She's glowing. There's flowers, there's balloons. And the bumbling husband with all the bags trying to get into the car. And like, he's the punchline.
Yes.
Right. He's always the punchline.
He doesn't know what to do. He's not helpful.
Right. Like she's the only one that knows how to care. Like he right. babysits. He doesn't take care of his child. Right. We have all of these narratives about who the man is in the parenting dynamic. And I will tell you, as a gay man who had a child through adoption and a child through surrogacy, and so I played both roles. I didn't have the mother at home taking care of my child. When I walked out of the hospital, I didn't get the wheelchair, right? I walked out with my baby in my arm and my bag in my other arm, and out the hospital I walked. I had to open the door myself and put the bags in myself, put the baby in myself. So I'm interested because these are the kinds of dynamics, because as we start creating families in these much more diverse ways, and we start really bringing some of these options and opportunities into the mainstream. Now, we've been doing this for 2-3 decades now, but it is only now that we're starting to talk about these in a more mainstream way. And, you know, Andrea, I think that your story is so critically important because we don't talk about people in your position and in your role. You're right. We don't talk about it. Just like we don't talk about non-gestating husbands.
No. And it's a really, you know, we almost glamorize it for women when we do talk about it, because it's like, oh, you're so lucky you didn't have to gain pregnancy weight. Trust me. I would have switched 8 years of shots, or however many I did, thousands of shots in my belly and my backside for the chance to carry a pregnancy to term. But I think, like, in general, all of these things are so misunderstood. And that's then right. We become hyper experts when we're in it, because we have to be so overwhelmed with what we thought would be a different path to parenthood. And so then we start reading and we start learning and everything. And I think, you know, it's slowly changing. You know, I joked on a panel, one of our live events a few months ago, I said to the audience, it's a good time to be infertile. And then I said, wait, let me re-say that. It's never a good time to be infertile. I just mean that there's more resources, support, conversation online and offline than I ever saw a decade ago. And I'm sure, Elliott, same for you when you were going through your modern family building, and Davina all of us in this. So it's a very different era. It's not a good time. We still have a far way to go, but it's better.
It's better. And, you know, that brings me to, I know there are probably questions waiting for you guys, but I still have another question that I think is important. In the phone calls that I receive, what I hear in people's voices is fear, that they want to broach the subject with their partner about improving the sex life, but they don't know how to do it without hurting the other person's feeling. And I think that is an obstacle that both men and women have to figure out. And I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
I think that underneath the fear, though, is grief and shame.
Yeah.
And I think that it's the grief and shame that we need to touch. You know, it's the expectation of who I was supposed to be as a sexual being, who I was supposed to be as a partner, you know, the grief, the loss of the relationship I thought I was going to have, the way that I thought I would see myself when I grew up as this empowered person, like the loss of identity. There's so much personal stuff that drives that fear and the inability. And then you layer on top of that, I don't actually have the communication skills to have that kind of conversation, because nobody ever taught me that. And it probably wasn't modeled at home, right? So I have all this guilt, all this shame, and then I layer on top of that a skill deficit. And then I feel stuck, right? It's really hard.
It kind of brings us full circle, right?
It is. I mean, I so agree. We're not taught it. I think one of the biggest misconceptions in relationships is that sex comes naturally, that we don't have to negotiate and communicate like we do about money and anything on our plate in a relationship. The difficult conversations are exactly the ones we have to have, you know, always. Right. And those are the ones. And, you know, one of my tips, and I always say I'm credible, not clinical. Elliott's more, has clinical background. Mine is, I'm a journalist. I've researched relationships as a journalist for a number of years. So it's grounded in research, but it's not, you know, clinical research. But one of my biggest pieces of advice that worked for me, so I can say anecdotally helpful, was sometimes broaching these topics in the dark. You know, you can have a conversation that's really intimate at night with the lights out, if you're kind of too shy to look someone in the eye and have it. And another thing that I think is an amazing discovery, I made it while I was interviewing people for Cheat on Your Husband with Your Husband. I would ask couples to ask each other, you know, your partner, what time of day, people never ask this, what time of day is your ideal time to, you know, get it on? People never ask these kind of questions, but one of the couples I was working with, they discovered together that he's too exhausted at night. So he's like really not that into it. It's not that he was rejecting his wife as much as he really was tired, and morning is better for him. And they kind of settled on weekend afternoons. Okay. But the point is that there's all these things we have to negotiate and communicate through. And plan to be spontaneous is one of my other big tips in my books, which is like, it doesn't sound sexy to plan sex, but sometimes you can have a lot of fun leading up to that. Just to like keep it, you know, keep it going.
I think that the other thing is these questions, Andrea, that you're on are so important. One of the questions that I often ask is, how much sex do you think we're supposed to be having? And what is it supposed to look like? You know, because again, if we have these false notions, especially if we've learned about sex from porn, or from friends, and we don't have a real good solid sex education, we don't know what it's supposed to look like. And we think it's supposed to last for 2 hours. And, you know, sometimes right. a good 7 minutes in heaven is enough, right? And I think that if we can just get a little bit more realistic about that, helps.
Mm-hmm. Jennifer, you have a question for us?
A person here in the webinar is still with us, and they wrote, I feel inadequate and it adds negativity to our day-to-day existence. Any suggestions?
This is something I hear so much because it's this sense of inadequacy that we get in so many ways, because partially it's the inadequacy of my role. So if we're facing a fertility challenge, and I'm very particular with my words when I work with couples, and I, you know, when people start saying it's infertility, I'm like, no, it's a fertility challenge, right? Because we don't know, we have to figure out what the challenge is to see if we can get you there before we determine whether it's infertility. Like right now, things just aren't working the way you want to. But if we're talking about inadequacy because we're not achieving the goals that we, as we've set them, then we need to have some conversation about goals and what goals look like, and to challenge this narrative you have in your head of, you know, 7 minutes of heaven and the goal has been attained. If the inadequacy is because you're having struggles in who you are as a partner or the way you're feeling about your relationship, then, you know, part of that is, again, checking out assumptions. And what assumptions are you holding about your partner? And what assumptions are you holding about yourself? What assumptions do you think your partner has about you? And sometimes just talking about assumptions will start to clear some of that out. And I spend a lot of time with couples teaching them that there's actually a lot you can do right now today to change something. And Andrea, to build on to what you were talking about just a few minutes ago, is to really learn the power of flirting. We forget when we start getting into these parts of our relationship, we stop flirting with each other. And all we can think about is the dishes aren't done, the laundry's not done, you know, now you want me to have sex with you, and I am tired. But, you know, those little flirty things that happen during the week, the buildup, Esther Perel, who many of you may have read, has this great quote that I just love, which is, foreplay starts at the end of the last orgasm, right? And it's everything that builds up to the next one is that's the foreplay, right? It's the way we do those things. It's the way we engage each other. And I think that is so insightful.
That's what my book is about. It's How to Date Your Husband, because we just become, you know, roommates sometimes. And when we feel inadequate, we, of course, and it's so normal. I have to tell you, whoever has shared that, I feel you so deeply. I think I know so many people, myself included, who hit a point in during infertility where I said to my partner, and I've heard this many times, you should have married blank. Mm-hmm. You should be with a more fertile woman. Like, you couldn't come out with these crazy things, because there's guilt behind the inadequacy. Oftentimes is guilt, shame. It's a medical issue. Infertility is a medical disease. I need to say that too, because I think we lose sight of that and we think it's our fault all the time when we might have a physical blockage. You know, in my case, I had endometriosis and fibroid tumors and all these things that wasn't my fault. And I would say to my husband, you should be with someone else, you know, these crazy things. So it's very normal to feel this way, but it's really hard to feel this way. It's not good for anyone for you to feel this way. And I think I totally agree with Elliott about dating your partner again, but also like reconnecting with parts of yourself that are not infertility again, mm-hmm. I think are really important, is really important for your sense of self-worth.
Even if it's unexplained infertility, you still have to look at it as a medical issue. And, you know, part of this shame, this piece of disconnect, and I'm going to, because again, it's Men's Health Month, I want to address it from the men's perspective. If it's a man who's feeling inadequate or feeling less than, we don't raise boys to cope with that well. And that's part of the toxic masculinity that we turn on ourselves, right? Oftentimes we think about toxic masculinity as the way we reach out into the world and the way we treat others. But men are more likely to turn that toxic masculinity inward and break themselves down to attack themselves. In this sense, again, of as long as I'm a good provider, and good provider, as I mentioned before, isn't just about financial or worldly goods. I'm supposed to provide a baby. And I can't tell you how many men have sat in my office in a devastated mindset saying, I had one job and one job only. I was supposed to give her a baby and I couldn't do it. And I'm like, we need to break that down.
Yeah, like, totally.
And the pure, and we don't see the devastation men go through because they don't talk about it and they don't go to all of the appointments. And that's why if you're going to do this and you have to do it as a partnership, you got to be in it. Oftentimes I'll get a female partner in. I'll be like, where's your partner? I'm like, I want him in this office. And I'm like, tell him to come once. Tell him to come once and meet
me. Yeah.
Right? Because I know if I can get him in once, there's a strong likelihood I can get him to come back because I am immediately going to talk about the guilt and the shame and the fear and the identity. Because once I start talking about it, he's going to be like, oh, he gets me. Because nobody, no doctor's office, no reproductive endocrinologist, no nurse is going to sit to a guy and say, tell me about your fear and shame and guilt.
No.
No, they say, take the cup and go in the other room and produce
the sound. Right. Yeah.
I'd like to have sex with my partner more frequently, but keep hearing that frequent sex can affect the sperm count. I know that's probably an old wives' tale, but is there any science behind this?
Go ahead, Andrea.
Yeah, well, there is, and I'm not a medical expert, but I run a fertility site. There is some science behind that. You're not completely wrong, but men have a lot of sperm. Thank you for correcting me. Most men have a lot more sperm than we have eggs. Okay. Most men, not all. And in that case, I think they tell you generally when you're cycling, especially with IUI, not to have too much sex around that time when he has to drop off a sample and, you know, because of that. But I don't think overall during the month, there's a huge risk for having more sex. But Elliott, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I'm right with you, Andrea. I think it's just watch that small little window of when his sample is going to be needed, but the rest of the month, have fun, mm-hmm. right? Go have fun. And again, remember that really good sex doesn't have to be penetrative. If all you're thinking about is penis and vagina sex, you're missing a lot of fun things. And we should probably have a conversation about how to stretch out your menu because that menu is big. It's like a cheesecake factory, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of really fun things you could be having.
And I think that's a great point. I know when I was a patient, there was a period of time when before we could afford, you know, expensive fertility treatments, the doctor said, have sex every other day between days 10 and 22. And you would think, you know, they wouldn't tell you to take a break, you know, of one day if it could be every single day. But at the same time, you don't have to wait so long because every other day was sufficient. But it wasn't easy every other day, you know, for that many days in a row to make it fun and exciting. You had to get creative. I would love to hear some creative ideas for people. Do you have any resources or suggestions, Elliott? Andrea.
Can I just say, first of all, I don't think, and I have a feeling, Elliott, you're going to agree with me, but I don't think like, go have sex. That kind of advice is not very helpful. It starts way outside of the bedroom. I mean, if I were coaching a couple, it would be to date each other every other day, to court each other, to flirt with each other, not always leading, again, as Elliott said, to sexual penetration. Because then you're going to desire the sex more. So that would have been my tweak on his advice, personally. Yeah.
The way that I would tweak it is I have an exercise that I do with couples often. I call it the keeper of the relationship. And I say, you're each going to take a week. Like, this is your week, and then that's your week, and you're going to keep going back and forth week by week. And when you're the keeper of the relationship, you have to do something every day, 5 to 15 minutes, that lets your partner know why you appreciate them, what you see in them, why you're in this relationship. You know, you're going to, you know, if she really loves Swiss dark chocolate, maybe you get some Swiss dark chocolate and you tell her about, you know, a vacation you went on and why you love being with her, right? If he really loves foot rubs, maybe you're going to say, hey, for today, I'm going to give you 15 minutes of foot rubs. But, you know, for a week, you just become the keeper of the relationship. And next week, you get to be the receiver of the keeper of the relationship. And it's those little things, which is leading into, you know, all the stuff that Andrea talks about how to date your partner. And I just formalize it for them, because sometimes I wasn't good at dating in the first place, right? Dating sucked to start with.
So, can we be more like-minded, Elliott? In my book, I have an exercise called King and Queen for a Day. Exactly. But there's research behind what Elliot's saying, because John Gottman did research showing we need five positive interactions to negate one negative interaction. It's called the 5-to-1 rule. So what this kind of thing, and it's an acknowledgement exercise, actually, depositing, and I love switching off per week, but depositing these little small, sweat the small stuff, these little small gestures actually helps you weather the big storms. Always. There's research to substantiate that.
Well, the other thing is, how nice is it to get to receive for a whole week, just keep receiving. And by the way, when you're giving that kind of gratitude and acknowledgement in person, science will also tell you that you actually feel better about yourself. Mm-hmm. When you tell somebody that you respect them, that you're thankful for them, that you give them positive feedback, and you see that positive response back, you actually feel better about yourself. Mm-hmm. So it goes both ways, both weeks. You just switch roles.
Yeah. Jennifer, do you have another?
We have a long question, but the basic gist is that going through loss, recurrent miscarriage, or something along those lines, some people, their coping is to turn inward, makes them feel less connected. How do they feel more reconnected when they're individually maybe coping with losses along the way differently?
Grief is a really interesting phenomena. And there's a very particular kind of grief that is situated in a fertility challenge, and it's called disenfranchised grief. Mm-hmm. And grief in and of itself, grief is the concept that as human beings, we cannot conceptualize that something is actually lost and gone and I can't reconnect to it. Like when somebody dies, what do you mean I can't reconnect to that person? I can't conceptualize that person is actually gone. I get fired, right? I can't conceptualize that I don't have that job anymore. That's really what grief is. It's the inability to go back and reconnect to something that's missing. Disenfranchised grief is the grief that is not socially supported. There is something about this grief that if I say it, I will break, or if I say it, I won't get the support I need. I will be judged negatively for it. And infertility, there is boundless disenfranchised grief. People who are grieving and they can't talk about their infertility because somebody says, yeah, but think about all the freedom you have. You get to go on vacation. I don't get to go on vacation, right? Or when somebody has a miscarriage, and they go to their fertility support group and they say, I've miscarried. And somebody says, well, at least you got pregnant. At least you could do that, right? And there are these little comments, these really painful comments that teach us very quickly not to let that grief show. And so we try to swallow it down and it becomes this hard coal center right here in our heart. And especially if we're doing that with our partner and our partner can't work with us on our grief, and I don't care what role you're playing in this relationship, it is that ability to acknowledge that loss and that even if that loss, and somebody says to you, well, at least you can try again. But that try again is not a replacement for this loss. And I don't want to put this loss on that baby. So if I'm lucky enough to try again and I actually get pregnant and I can have a child, I don't want that child to carry the burden of this loss. Mm-hmm. This loss is a loss complete. And our ability to work through that, and I'm going to tell you, if you're feeling that kind of loss and if you're feeling the struggle, please find a really good therapist who understands fertility and who will work with you on that grief and loss, because it's not going to just dissipate naturally.
Mm-hmm. I 100% again agree with you, Elliott. I just want to add, first of all, I'm so sorry for what you're experiencing. And I did an exercise I will never forget. I'm tearing up thinking about it. Because I had a lot of losses before my baby. And someone said to me, it was just like a suggestion from a friend who said, light a candle for every baby you thought you'd meet. And just you know, if you connect to this idea, try lighting a candle for every baby you thought you'd meet. And just say a prayer or connect or whatever, journal, whatever resonates.
Yeah.
And acknowledgement. So I did that and my husband walked in. Okay. Now, Michael, my husband's a science guy. He's like, he's very funny and wonderful. But he's like, he would think this was new agey weird stuff, I thought, right? So here I am in this dark room, bawling, crying, candles everywhere. And I was really vulnerable. And I said, and you can't have intimacy without vulnerability. And I told him what I was doing. And he cried with me. I mean, he hugged me and it was a real moment. And I had prejudged how he would respond to me sharing that with him. So we also don't always know where our partners are. We might be surprised. And there's ways to grieve with good friends, personally, on our own. And then ways to share our grief. And sometimes we just have to kind of see what those boundaries are, how we with our partners, and we'll find a way, and your instinct will tell you. Your instinct will tell you when you want to share it. That was my experience.
Andrea, that is such a beautiful story, and I'm really happy you shared that. I've never actually heard you tell me that before.
Yeah.
I got something new from you today, and we'll always get lots of new from you, but that's really powerful. So first of all, thank you for that. One of the things that I do with couples is I have them string beads. And this is a simple way, because people cannot conceptualize the intensity of the journey you're on. And so what I have them do is I go get a really long string and get all different kinds of beads, right? Little tiny yellow beads are every time you take a shot. You know, big blue beads are every time you do this procedure. You know, every time you have to go on birth control, you put a green bead. You know, every time you have, if you have a miscarriage, you put a big red bead, right? You just, and I have people string their journey from the very, very, very beginning. And these strung out journeys literally will circle my office two or three times, the intensity. But it's the only way they can actually quantify for people this is what we've done. Because you can tell the story, but people won't understand it. But when you can make it tactile like that, people's minds are blown. It's the only way people can see just what you've been through.
Yeah, Elliott, you said something once to me, talking about loss. And I remember thinking, yeah, but I'm not going to get the closure I want. Or I'm not going to get the closure I need. And you said, you'll get closure. It's just not the type of closure you had in mind.
That's right.
And that was so 100%, 1,000% straight on. And it changed my perception of how I was facing everything. It wasn't so daunting. It was more hopeful. That one singular change of thought, you are going to get your closure. It's not what you anticipated or the way you anticipated, but it will happen. This in a way can apply to those who have had loss, those who are going through the journey. I think even in our sexual relationships, we've had it in our mind that things are going to be a certain way. It's not going the way we anticipated, but if you can believe that in the long run, we can still come together and it may happen in a different way, but it can still happen. You can still have intimacy. You can still have a healthy sexual relationship, even during infertility. It's just, all of this is kind of bringing me to a full circle moment that you two are amazing. I love your books. I love listening to you talk to each other, that I get to engage and hear how you answer people. You're really tremendous.
Well, Elliott, Davina, And Andrea, thank you so, so much. Thank you to each and every one of you who've joined us. Fertility Within Reach's mission is to increase access to health benefits for all. And I want to remind you that this webinar is part of our Men's Health Month fundraising appeal. We appreciate it, any donation in any amount. Thank you for joining us and have a wonderful night.